Our moderator for this evening is Mr. Michael Stabler, Director of the Schiller Institute in the San Francisco Bay Area. Mr. Stabler and the Schiller Institute are strong supporters of the concept of the China Belt Road Initiative, and his organization is co-sponsoring the program this evening. Thank you for your support, Mr. Stabler. The podium is yours, Colonel.
The Schiller Institute role in this perspective. We've had a unique role in this perspective and this project, and you'll find that much of what Consul Su Jia presented in terms of a Chinese outlook is very close to the perspective of the Schiller Institute. What I'm going to show you is a short introduction, just a few minutes, of a video we put together by our founder, Helga Zeb LaRouche. Helga, Ms. LaRouche actually went to China in 1968 during the Cultural Revolution. And many of you may know what she saw there was somewhat shocking. Total poverty, very severe. She went on a Swedish shipping line, so she kind of snuck in. And she went back again in the 1990s, and she was stunned. She went back for a conference in 1995 on the discussion of a new Silk Road project. And she's gone back ever since, and the level of development from the 1960s to today is an absolute miracle. There's no other way to explain it, but it's one that is man-made. It was intended and it's been successful. So she has a very unique perspective and a very close emotional connection. So I'd just like to give you a sense of her outlook. It's very short, there's much more she could say and you could find out her on this question. And then I'll give you a little bit more. What I'd like to do is after this, is to give a sense of a little bit of our history, and then also a couple of major components that we see are critical, not just for China, but for development generally. What China's doing is not something unique to China. It is something that's universally available to China, to Russia, to Africa, and even to the United States, the kind of development projects. So here's the director, and then we'll move on.
You have heard about the ancient Silk Road, which connected China via a long trade route to Europe. It was an exchange of silk, porcelain, book printing, but more important than the goods was the exchange of technologies. The ancient Silk Road brought enormous economic benefits to all the countries participating. But it also was an exchange of ideas and beautiful cultures. Today, China is offering a new Silk Road and a maritime Silk Road. And already more than 60 countries are cooperating. China has made an economic miracle in the last 30 years, which brought a development which most industrial countries needed 150 to 200 years for. And now China is offering that same model for every country which wants to cooperate with that perspective. The new Silk Road is based on a win-win perspective. That is, that each country which participates in it has equal economic, cultural, and political benefits. It is a true idea to overcome geopolitics, that evil which caused two world wars in the 20th century. It offers the perspective of a true global development partnership, of all of mankind working together for the common aims of mankind. Now, we have produced a 370-page study, which is called The New Silk Road Becomes the World Land Bridge. Now, that book you want to read, it exists already in English. in Chinese and in Arabic. And very soon it will be out in German, in Korean, and many other languages to follow. Watch this video and you will get a glimpse how easy it is to change the world for the better.
Ruins all the surprise. Okay. So this is our perspective, which I think many people up here share. I think the president of China and the Chinese leadership also shares at this point. This is not something simply for Eurasia or even Africa. It changes our entire perspective of the world. This is a chance for all of mankind to participate in a rapid and accelerated rate of development. Without overstating anything, if this project was implemented by all major nations in Europe, the United States, and Asia, within the course of the coming decade, we could eliminate hunger, or starvation certainly, and hunger from the planet. The potential to do these kinds of things lies in what we decide to do today. Now, just quickly on the Schiller Institute, this was created by Lyndon and Helga LaRouche. In 1988, Lyndon foresaw the fall of the Berlin Wall. And as it came down in 1989, it meant a new perspective. What did we need to do now to bring East and West together? The Cold War had separated civilizations, Russia and China, and much of Asia from Europe and the United States. And the perspective we had was to end geopolitics, as Helga said, to create a program of global development. What we started with was the industrial triangle. You see Paris in France, you'll see Berlin in the north, and down in to the right is Vienna. To take this core area and bring Vienna, which was part of the Comecon Eastern Bloc, and begin to use that as the cornerstone for development of Eastern Europe and into Russia. We soon, as the Soviet system began to break down, and was eventually dissolved with unfortunate circumstances to the Russian and Soviet people, we went to Russia and asked them if they wanted to participate in a project of development like this, much of like what you see with the Belt and Road today, high-speed rail corridors, industry, production, and so on. As many as you can imagine, many in Russia were very excited, but they said one thing. Anybody have a guess? Yeah, no money, we're getting, our country is falling apart, it's getting torn to pieces, how could we possibly? But they gave us a good hint. They said there's some people in China who have accumulated a large amount of financial wealth and want to figure out what to do with it. So we entertained to a discussion. Now just to give a sense, you know, there's actually an economist who's come out and said that he's given a perspective that you can actually measure economic growth by the changes in emission of light on the planet from satellite data. Well, can you imagine, what areas do you see need economic growth? Central Asia? Africa? It's very clear, Eastern Russia? So you see, where the world needs development, where this Belt and Road paradigm becomes so critical and essential for the development of civilizations, it's so apparent, and the growth rates, if China can achieve 8%, 7%, certainly Africa could achieve, South America, Central Asia, 10, 15% growth rates given this perspective of development. Now, another layer was that we looked at China's history. And what we discovered was that a key figure in the founding of modern China was Sun Yat-sen, as many in this room likely know. Sun Yat-sen had a program of development for China, modeled on Abraham Lincoln's Transcontinental Railroad of the United States. This is Sun Yat-sen's map for rail development in China in around 1910. It's nearly what they've built in China today, with the most extensive, over 20,000 kilometers of high-speed rail. So you see the perspective. And so we integrated this and began to develop a perspective. As many of you know, this is Promontory, Utah. This is the meeting of the Transcontinental Railroad. And as many of you know, China built our first railroad, especially in California. We probably should bring it back to the second. Strikes a chord here in San Francisco, doesn't it? All right, so what we did, we attended, as I said, our director, Helga Sepp LaRouche, attended a summit in Beijing in 1996. We came back and produced this executive intelligence review as kind of our new service, the Eurasian Land Bridge, the new Silk Road locomotive for worldwide economic development. In the last chapter of this report, and of course, it's somewhat, you see the parallel discussion, The last chapter is on what the United States needs to do for development and big infrastructure and development. Now, had we known that in 1997, we wouldn't be talking about broken down subways in New York every single day, or you know how bad the BART system is. And then in 2014, as our director pointed out, the one in China was actually printed by Chaoyang Institute at Renmin University. And then we actually announced the Arabic one at the Transportation Ministry in Cairo, Egypt, as part of the development there. This is our director, Hafizat Larouche, at the May Forum, and she got a warm welcome. I don't know how many people got this, but it was nice to see. This is at the initial inaugural Belt and Road Forum in Beijing. And as many of you know, this was the famous dialogue television discussion on CGTN TV, probably the best cable channel out there these days. This is the map that we developed as a perspective. This is similar to what Raja had shown. And this is what we proposed for Africa. And it's so critical today. If you look at the map on the left with the black lines, every single one of those is probably a different gauge, meaning the tracks might be some meters this far. Each gauge can be different. Anybody know why each gauge is different? Right, because each colonial power that came to Africa built a different gauge railway. None of them can connect, and none of them were ever intended to. It was simply for extraction of resources out of one area, the mining areas, into the ports. So what China's building today in places like Kenya, the Mombasa to Nairobi, is called the Standard Gauge Railway. That's the railway of Europe, of China, the Standard Gauge, and they're going to build that all over Africa. They built it from Djibouti to Addis Ababa, Ethiopia. It's now built in Kenya. They plan to go all the way to Nigeria, from Cairo to Johannesburg. And this is the map Roger showed, it is a global perspective. We certainly think that key areas like moving into Africa, the Chinese are actually looking at a bridge from Italy to Messina. I'm sorry, a bridge, yeah, from Italy, the southern part of Italy to Sicily at Messina. There's also the potential of a Tunisian tunnel from Sicily, tunnel underground into Tunisia, into Africa. There's projects planned from Yemen. You've heard about all the fighting and problems in Yemen. Well, Yemen's a key real estate because it's going to be a tunnel from Yemen, already in discussion, into Djibouti. So these are key points of actually connecting these areas. You know the Bering Strait, as was mentioned by Roger. And in the south, it was American civil engineers, American Army Corps of Engineers, who in the 1890s had planned a railroad from the United States, from Chicago, down into South America. It's the Darien Gap. It's a swampland in north of Colombia and south of Panama. There's still no railroad to this day which connects North and South America. These projects can be solved. China's proven it. They just built the most remarkable bridge from Macau to Hong Kong. It's absolutely stunning. It'll be finished this year. And if that project can be built, I guarantee you every single one of the projects I just mentioned, which people would have said was impossible maybe 5 years ago, certainly 25 years ago, are more than feasible today. And of course, you know, if you're going to see population grow. It's just an important factor. You know, China's dealing with even needing more people today to support this kind of growth. Okay, now I want to get into two factors. One is, that's the broad sense. We can have questions and discussions for everyone, so I want to keep this brief. There's two requirements to any big projects. One is you got to have the power, you got to have the energy. And I'll give you a sense of what the energy requirements on this, because it's staggering, it's shocking, how many energy power plants you're going to build. And if you plan on doing it with coal, or oil, or solar, or wind, it's not going to happen. We're going to have to go to fusion, we're going to have to get to higher energy platforms, because you'll get a sense that this thing is going to require a lot of power. Now, and then the second thing will be on the financing, as Roger said. So on the energy requirements, New York to San Francisco is a little less than halfway of Beijing to Paris, and as Consul General Petrov mentioned, the first high-speed rail, much of high-speed rail right now is built internally to China. There are no high-speed rail projects. Everything going from Chongqing to Duisburg is diesel, traditional rail. And there's a reason why, right? And the probably reason why it's high speed is because you're getting rid of that diesel engine. and you're powering it by electricity in the line. The rail line is electric. If you're going to do that with a basic train, say 1,000 tons, traveling at high-speed rates of, say, 250 kilometers per hour, for every 1,000 kilometers, you need nearly a gigawatt of electricity. For that one train, you need an entire power plant for that one train to go that 1,000 kilometers. That means to go from Beijing to Paris would take about 7 gigawatts. It would take about 3 to go from New York to San Francisco. One train going from New York to San Francisco would take 3 major power plants just to function. Right now, there's about 4 trains going through Kazakhstan, the main central area of the New Silk Road corridor. There's about 4 trains a day. That's 28 gigawatts if they were high-speed rail going from Beijing to Paris. And if you increase that, which they intend to, by 30 times a day, with just the next 10 years, you're talking 210 gigawatts of power just to run those trains. That's 200 power plants, big power plants. So you're going to have some energy. Now, China's considering this. China is actually leading the world in certain aspects of fusion research. They actually are only one of 2 places which are leading in this area. The other is South Korea. They're both using superconducting magnetic fusion programs. This is the inside of one. This is taking a hydrogen plasma and getting it hotter than the sun, so it's not touching any of the surface. It's a remarkable technology. And it will produce, it produces energy based on a bucket full of seawater will produce energy for a month. So the cost of energy supply is absolutely zero. It's just a question of harnessing the technology. And it's remarkable, and it really is the future of mankind if we develop this kind of project. It's the only way you're really gonna do it. Of course, it's totally clean. The waste is water, or the waste is helium, I'm sorry, the waste is helium. And it's certainly a technology that's under development. Just to give people a sense, everybody in the United States, this has been a big discussion, if there's any engineers in the audience. Since the 70s, everyone said they've been working on fusion, and so everyone says it's never possible. You know, cynicism is not unique. I mean, we're pretty saturated with that in the United States, right? Everything is impossible. Where are you gonna get the money, and so on. Well, that was really the question. If you just real quick, if this is in the head of anyone, the Department of Energy laid out 4 pathways that we would have commercial fusion plants in the United States starting in 1976. You have to fund it at necessary levels. The blue line, the highest one, is the fastest pace. By 1976, we could have had commercial fusion by 1990. You just have to fund the experiments. You have to back it up politically and financially. If you want to slow it down, 93, a little slower, 98, or 2005. If you fund it at the levels of 1978, you'll never get to fusion. And the black line, which is below 1978 funding, is what we actually funded fusion. So people say, well, it's never going to happen. Well, if you don't back it, it doesn't happen. So it is a very possible energy supply. This is not dream stuff. Now, even more seemingly dream-like programs, part of China's Belt and Road perspective, is an intense moon lunar exploration program. They're the first nation to plan on landing on the far side of the moon. We've never been there, no robotics, no men, ever been to the far side of the moon. The reason why is you lose radio communications. If you don't send a satellite even farther out to be able to be in constant discussion with the Earth as well as the far side. The reason the moon is so important, it's rich in a fusion fuel source called helium-3. And that changes the fusion energy supply to be even more efficient. So China is committed to this. The Europeans, our astronauts, if you didn't know, all of our astronauts learn Russian. All of the European astronauts learn Russian, and now they're learning Chinese. And ours will probably learn the same soon. The European Space Agency is ready to develop a lunar base. Russia is very excited about this. And of course, all of this United States space community wants to be involved. It's simply a political reason. And it's absolutely an aim why we don't work with China on space collaboration. Okay, but that's big. Those are big discussions, big ideas. Where do you need the money for all of this? I've given lectures on a number of large infrastructure projects. I've gone to a number of campuses, Cal State Fresno, San Diego State University, the big infrastructure projects we could build here in the United States. First question out of every class. First question, literally. Great, we want to do it. These are construction engineers and civil engineers. We're ready. Where are you going to get the money? So where do they get all this money? And I don't know, maybe do people have any idea? Is it just because they're communists, they just have money? As most people think, well, it's communists. They just have money. I'll give you a secret. I thought this was very funny. There's a professor at a university locally who's from China. He says, do you think China's communist? And I said, I guess so. I've never been there. He says, California is far more communist than China will ever be. Okay, so how many people here have heard of Glass-Steagall? The banking reform. Okay, it's legislation. There's legislation in the House and Senate right now. China passed it in 1993. So after about 15 years of opening up China under Deng Xiaoping's leadership and a lot of, you know, the cheap labor policies, bringing in a lot of manufacturing, and a lot of foreign reserves, they said, we've got to change the way our money's flowing. Everybody knows about the billionaire communists and these kinds of problems that China was facing socially. They had to make changes in how their banking system worked. And it's not unlike what Franklin Roosevelt did in the United States to get the United States out of the Great Depression and build and industrialize the United States with the Tennessee Valley Authority, or the Hoover Dam, or the Grand Coulee Dam. How we built the great projects in the early 20th century is how China is building, doing it today. If China can do it, why can't we? Now, additionally, they set up four large banks in 1978 under Deng Xiaoping's leadership. Many people know this is the four of them. They're the four of the top five biggest banks in the world. This is Bank of China, Industrial and Commerce Bank of China, that looked at industry, China Construction Bank, and then Agricultural Bank of China. Now, those three, oh, I'm sorry, yeah, I skipped to 1995, didn't I? Anyway, so those big four were shifted from state-owned banks to commercial banks to expand credit even more. And in 1994, they established three new banks specifically, not to take deposits, not to be your local branch, but to specifically fund. It was set up under the State Council, and they were specifically to fund the large development projects of China, the high-speed rail systems that are now 20,000 kilometers. These banks, the China Development Bank, as Roger mentioned, the Ex-Im Bank, or Export-Import Bank of China, and the Agricultural Development Bank of China, by some estimates, fund 90% of the Belt and Road in other countries. I did a special case study of the corridor going into Pakistan. That's how they're funding the project. They set up banks, they capitalize those banks. It's called national banking. It's actually something invented in the United States in the 18th century by Alexander Hamilton. We developed this over 200 years ago as a banking system in the United States. We kind of looked at it and said, how do we do it? How do we develop it? We've got the reserves. We've got to get out of this cheap labor program. And they took up national banking, not just for China, but it's happening all over the world. Now, what's the point of this? Here, just a quick sense of the difference between what national banking looks like when you set up these kinds of state banks and private banking looks like. Why it makes such a difference. And it's so obvious when you just look at the basic numbers. Just take a $10 billion loan. $10 billion. Which would, I think the estimates by China's investment corporation, their estimates is that the United States needs $8 trillion in infrastructure development. $8 trillion. We have a proposal right now from our current government of $1 trillion over the next 10 years. We need $1 trillion every year for the next 10 years. To borrow $10 billion from J.P. Morgan or Citibank or any of the big five Wall Street banks for infrastructure, they'll lend at 12%. They'll do the same thing to other countries. Why do you think that there's such a major infrastructure gap, though we have the World Bank or the IMF and these other institutions, the Asian Development Bank? If you borrow $10 billion at 12% and have to pay it back in 10 years, you have to pay back $30 billion. But infrastructure takes time. The Belt and Road is most of China's loans to countries like Pakistan or Kenya or Kazakhstan or Poland. These are 30 or 40 year loans. If you lend at 12% for 40 years, that country will have to pay back, after borrowing $10 billion in 40 years, they'll have to pay back nearly $1 trillion. It's called, you put countries into debt slavery. If nations borrow at that, they will never pay it back, and they will never get the development they need. Instead, China's lending at 1-2%. These banks, the China Development Bank, the Export-Import Bank, are lending at, so just say it's at 1.6%. After a $10 billion loan, to pay it back in 40 years, that means you build the project, say it takes 5 to 10 years to build, then you operate that way. They're building a bunch of power plants in Pakistan. They loan the money to Pakistan. Pakistan borrows it and they build up the power plants. Then they sell the power, they build up their industry, they build up their economy, and in 40 years, they pay back just almost $19 billion. It's almost like free money. But what is the money now achieving? It's in achieving an entirely new nation in Pakistan. It's achieving major development. It's taking people out of poverty, taking people out of lack of education, and integrating them into high skills, high development, and real levels of education. That's the whole point, isn't it? That used to be the American dream, and that is the China dream today. It's the human dream. It's the development method. And I'll just say again, if China can do it, why can't we? So I'll basically end my presentation there. And basically we'll open up. We do have the World Land Bridge reports. People, as our director said, people want to, I'm getting provoked to say this. If people are interested, you could take a look at our material and order them, and we can send them to you in the mail. So I just want to give a quick sense. How is China actually doing this? What are the requirements on energy, and how are they doing it? Because you should walk out of this not just with an excitement about the project or a knowledge, but a sense of that this is how it can be done, it can be implemented, and it could be implemented here in the United States. Jerry Brown just took, I think, 90 businessmen over to China. Every state in our country, every province in Germany, all of these nations are working with China on this kind of development. We've got to get a real policy change. So, like I said, it's a global development. So I think that brings to an end our formal proceedings. And so let's give a warm welcome, gratitude for our special guest speakers. Let's give a special thank you to Roger Gong for making sure all of this happened. Post, and I believe Veterans Post 448, Veterans for Peace, which also supported this.